Of your forecast order fulfillment. How do you get your customer their stuff
that they ordered?
Manufacturing flow. How do you have flexibility and low cost in your manufacturing? Especially if we're living in the world of outsourcing where you have contract manufacturers all over the world. Product development and commercialization. That sounds very much like R&D. How is that really supply chain? Well, I'll give you a quick example. The iPhone 5 had a lot of great features and all of that, and people talked about that, but I should have cut this out and put it on this slide. The one thing that people, I think it was Bloomberg, they said, you know what, that was the first big major launch by Tim Cook alone without Steve Jobs, and it really showed what he was good at. It launched in 30 countries on the same day. Last year, the iPhone 4S launched in, I think, something like 5 or 10 countries at once. That's supply chain. You're building up the product and you're getting it to the store on, whenever it was introduced, it was available. You didn't run out. You wanted a little bit of a shortage to get the line around the building, but in the end, everybody got their iPhone 5. And then finally, returns management. And by returns management, I don't mean, like in financial terms, return on investment. I mean, product can sometimes come back to you. And that can be a significant major headache. I worked on a project with Philips Consumer Electronics, and they basically made something like an iPod clone 7 or 8 years ago. They had returns rate of 30%. So for every product that was sold, 30% came back. And how do you deal with that? So these are the 8 processes, and we here are our little silos in here, and it really means that all of these processes, you implement them cross-functionally. You have people from production, R&D, marketing, sales, logistics, purchasing, and so on, working on these. Even customer relationship management, there are logistics issues, there are finance issues that need to be discussed. Bring everybody in. And I think our curriculum really reflects that. We have classes that you can take from different areas, and they all help you basically get a better appreciation of what supply chain management is. The other thing is, okay, now you have your network of companies, how do you implement it? He said, okay, everybody needs to be involved. You have these business processes. When you look at some other concepts of supply chain management, the reason why I like this one so much is, let's say that there's one, if you're familiar with it, there's the SCORE model, and it really says supply chain operational reference or something like that. It's really about purchasing operations and logistics. Let's think about that for a second. Purchasing operations and logistics, that's supply chain management. But let's forget the supply chain stuff for a second. Can you manage one company with purchasing operations and logistics? How? Now, how could you then manage a network of companies which is much broader with purchasing operations and logistics? You need finance, you need marketing, you need R&D. So, logically, it doesn't make sense, and that's why we have to think very broadly. Now, in a way, the trouble we have is, you hear the term supply chain management, and you think, well, I know what management is, but then managing the supply chain, that must be something smaller than management. No, really, it's bigger. This is just a chart, don't worry about it too much. It just shows that every business function, marketing, sales, R&D, and so on, has something to contribute to each of the 8 supply chain processes. Other things that you need to think about in supply chain management: planning, control methods. How do you make sure that stuff keeps going the same way? Workflow structure. You don't really think cross-functionally. You have outsourcing partners and service providers and so on. Who does the work? How does the work get done? There's an interesting discussion we had this week about sort of really trying to educate people so they can be valuable for companies to hire. And what are the things that they need to know nowadays? And it used to be that companies wanted to hire people that knew something about inventory management and transportation, and maybe a little bit of warehousing and so on. Now, companies are looking for people who can manage a third-party logistics provider, who can run projects, who's in charge of a product launch or things like that. That's really what employers are looking for these days, and it has changed from the past. Organization structure. How do you structure your organization so you can reflect the need for this involvement in the supply chain? How do you structure knowledge? How do you maintain knowledge? How do you communicate? Maybe your suppliers all over the world. And there's behavioral issues. How do you get people to get their work done in the supply chain? And one may be down the hallway from you, but the other one sits in Shenzhen, China, and it's part of a contract manufacturer that you have. Power and leadership. That's always a fun one. You can look at it sort of from several perspectives. One is, who in the company has the power and the leadership? Let's take an example. The Coca-Cola company. I see a Sprite there and there. Most powerful brand in the world. I think marketing has a lot of power there. And if they want to introduce Coke Light or Diet Coke, Coke Zero, different sizes and shapes and cans and bottles, they can do that. And it is a major issue for the guy who has to produce different stock keeping units in his factories, and finance will not allow him to expand his factories. It really becomes a challenge. But every time you talk to somebody who works in the consumer packaged goods industry, they say, well, one customer, treat them very differently from the other customer. Those guys down in Bentonville, Arkansas, Walmart, changed everything. It used to be that 20 years ago, that's a cool story, company of the year was Rubbermaid. 15 years later, company of the year was Walmart. And the power from the manufacturer who would sell to little retailers has changed from Walmart basically to say, okay, these are our terms. Want to sell with Walmart or not? It's your choice. Culture and attitude. Not talking about national cultures specifically, but each company has a different culture. And you have to deal with that. You have to be familiar with these things. Trust and commitment. You can't have partnerships with your suppliers and customers if you don't trust each other. Now, this chart right here just shows you that what we have is, we have the essential links, which is CRM and SRM, customer relationship management and supplier relationship management, and they form the essential links, and all the other processes, all the other things are coordinated through them. But it also shows another issue, which is the issue of supply chain performance. How do you know that the supply chain as a whole is better off? Well, in essence, performance, to me, in terms of companies, is very simple. Revenue minus cost equals profit. If on the whole supply chain, everybody makes more money after you pay off all the bills, then the whole supply chain is better off. If somebody makes more money but at the expense of everybody else in the supply chain is not better off. It would be nice if we could sort of wrap this up in one measure, but I've not seen a good supply chain measure. The other thing is, you can look at one instance here, it's customer relationship management. If you do that well, how does it impact the overall company? If you're able to increase sales, lower cost of goods sold, increases gross margin, increases net profit, and so on, and then leads to more value. So the three decisions in supply chain management, one is the network structure, who are your customers, who are your suppliers, and how do you shape relationships with them? what kind of processes do you have? Maybe you don't have to return, so you don't need to deal with returns.